So, I do not see other questions at the moment. Okay, so maybe we can switch to the next, I would say to the next moderator. So it's Sergei. I leave the control to Sergei because I'm embarrassed. Okay.
So next our speaker.
Let me thank once again Professor Lucini for his lesson and looking forward for the next one this afternoon. Yes. So please, Sergei, go.
We now move to the next speaker, Claudia Conti, and it was very nice historical introduction. I agree it's important and interesting to see how history of neural networks developed, and I believe Claudia will be giving us very up-to-date examples, in particular of the easing machine, which was mentioned. So it's very interesting way how physics is meeting neural networks and machine learning and learning in general. So Claudio, floor is yours.
Yes, thanks a lot for the introduction. I think that this online conference are changing the way we do the conferences in some sense. So it's nice to check how these things are changing. By the way, this talk is oriented to a specific application, which is strongly related to machine learning, as I will try to convince you. And this application is easing machine, so fabricating a device that has a specific specific goal. So I start activity that I'm going to describe has been mainly developed in Rome at the Department of Physics. Inside the Department of Physics, there is also an institute, which is the Institute for Complex Systems. And this activity has been developed by myself, by Davide Pierangeli, by Giulia Marcucci, who is now a postdoc in Ottawa, in the group of Bob Boyd. Then there is also a very evolving and interesting collaboration with Daniel Brunel, Vimushe Grafayeyan, and Sylvain Gigan in Paris. So I have two lessons in this school, and I have two goals. The first goal that I have is to introduce the students to complexity and computing and all the related features, in particular to understand why these things are important or may be important in the future. And the second goal that I have is to show you the simplest way you can do classical photonic computing. So assuming that you have a small lab in a university and you want to start these things, I think that it is not a complicated story. You do not need large funding. You can start playing with this with students with a very simple equipment. And in particular, so I have to show you, I want to show you two different tasks, two different things that you can do with machine learning and photonics. These two different things are actually related to the two main direction that I can identify in the modern data-driven science, in particular or in photonics, but this is true also in computer science. I mean, there are two different branches. One is related to combinatorial optimization. And the other one is actually a set of different tasks that you can do with conventional, in some sense, machine learning. When you start doing machine learning, you typically face with some coding interface, and you can do classification, clustering, Q-learning, all these things. These are the typical examples that you find when you open and start working on some toolbox for doing machine learning, say with Mathematica, MATLAB, Python, etc. So the two, of course, the two tasks, the two main branches are strongly related, but actually in terms of photonics, they are a little bit different. So if you want to do this by photonics, you have to do little different things, but I will show you that the two can be done with the same optical setup. So you can build a simple setup and then you can start playing with combinatorial optimization or with machine learning. So the two setups are actually two machines that you can build by a single optical device, which is a spatial light modulator. A spatial light modulator is actually the device that enables us to change the game in photonics. So we were used in the past to work with photonics to say you have a laser beam, then you have some sample, then you launch the sample in you launch the beam in the sample and see what happened. Nowadays, we change a little bit the story because we have this class of devices that are spatial light modulators that enable a very precise control on the shape of the beam, and hence they enable to encode a lot of information in your optical beam. And so you can see how your propagation elaborate and change this information. By using this simple device, which is actually a mirror that change the field in terms of amplitude and phase in different points, you can fabricate in your laboratory either easy machines that are machines that enable combinatorial optimization, or you can build another kind of machine that I will describe, which is named the extreme learning machine. The extreme learning machine is just a sort of neural network that enable to do machine learning tasks. And at the end of the day, your setup is super simple. You just have a laser beam that goes through a spatial light modulator. Then there is some propagation. Eventually, you may include some kind of sample, and I will describe the kind of samples that you do. And then you have some image and you process the image. So you will also use some conventional computer to process data, to make your input and process the output. And you can do this with a simple continuous wave laser without using a pulsed laser or complex stuff. And this is quite interesting because typically you issue with problem related with stability and temporal drift and these kind of things. And so using a continuous wave laser to do some machine learning is probably the simplest thing that you can do. So in the first lesson, I will talk about combinatorial problems and easy machine. I will describe how you can do an easy machine by a simple spatial light modulator, that is by a single device. And I will also talk about annealing strategy. So in the second lesson will be more on machine learning, more conventional machine learning. So to describe combinatorial optimization, let me tell you about a simple optimization problem, which is the so-called number partitioning. This is a simple problem in terms of its description, but actually is a very hard problem in terms of its solution to be found by computer programs. So the problem can be described as follows. Assume that you have a cake which is done of several different slices, and you want to divide this cake into two groups. So you can just do this. But this is not the only solution, because for example, this group wants this piece of cake. So maybe there is another solution, which is this. So this is a super simple problem, but you can realize that there is not a single solution. There are many, many different solutions. And this is the cake version of the number partitioning problem that now I want to describe with more detail from a more mathematical point of view, which will be super simple at the end of the day. So in the number partitioning problem, you have a certain set of real numbers, say x1, x2, that you can see in the screen. I hope that you can see. Okay. So x1, say, is equal to 1.2, then you have x2. Then you have x2, then you have x3, and so on and so forth. So we have a set of real numbers. And these are your slices of different cakes. for example. And then you want to divide this set of real numbers into two groups. And we call, for example, the first group S1, so we can collect these first pieces of cake in the group S1, and then we have this other group that we call S2. Our goal is to choose these numbers in a way such that the two partitions are balanced, meaning that the sum of the real number in one group is nearly equal to the sum of the real numbers in another group. So in general, you can do this by starting trial and error, so taking different numbers and collecting and see if this relation is satisfied. But you realize that doing this in a systematic way, that is trying all the possible combinations, is not an easy story. In particular, if you have, say, 20 numbers, it will take a lot to try all the possible combinations. So you may argue if it is there is a way to do this by a program, by some code. And one approach is to consider some function, for example, the difference of the two sums of these numbers squared, because the sign is not important. And you want to try a way to minimize this function by varying the way you take the samples in your overall set of real numbers. So doing this by trial and error is really a complex story, but there is a trick, a very simple trick, which is the following. You can attribute to each number one spin. So all the numbers in one group will have spin one. Spin is just a binary variable. It can be either plus one or minus one. So all the numbers in the first group will have spin one, and all the numbers in the second group will have spin minus one. So why you do this trick? Because you realize that if you do this, if you attribute to each number one spin that can be either plus one or minus one, you realize that your function to be minimized has a very intriguing shape, which is just the sum over all the numbers of the product of the spin, which you name sigma, times the corresponding real number squared. And this is quite straightforward, because if you look to the expression of this function, this will be the part with spin equal to one, and this will be the part with spin equal to minus one. So the spin is just a trick to collect these two terms into a single one. Then this is a squared sum, so it is a doubled sum that can be rewritten as follows. So you have a quadratic function of the spin times the product of the two numbers. And this is a very interesting outcome, because at the end of the day, you have a function which must be minimized, which is a quadratic function of the spins with some coefficient in front of that. These coefficients are named couplings, and in our example, they are determined by the real numbers. So your goal now is mapped to finding the spin that make this function minimal. Now, each different configuration of the spin is actually a different partition of the real number, a different way to divide your cake. So by simple arguments, you transform your number partitioning problem to the problem of finding the minimal configuration of the spin for this kind of function that we call H. It's the so-called Hamiltonian, and the couplings are determined by your original real numbers. This is quite an interesting and simple way to show how you can map a combinatorial optimization problem with a practical outcome, which is you divide your cake into a more mathematical fashion. And so we have found a mapping to the so-called easing model. This model has a long and celebrated story in physics. It dates back to 100 years ago. Its first formulation was this one. So the goal was to find the minimum of this function. And this was introduced by Isinger, and this was the thesis under the supervision of Lenz 100 years ago. So after 100 years, we are still working on this problem. Actually, the story has been more a little bit complicated because nowadays we refer as the Isinger Hamiltonian to this kind of function. Notice that there is a minus here, but this is just a notation. You can put you can redefine this one, this coupling coefficients, and it's the same. You can also find other expression in which there is one out here. So it's not important. What is important is that this is a quadratic function of the spin. And quite important is the fact that the spin are binary variables. So this can be plus one or minus one. And then you can have couplings that can be positive or negative in general. This was particularly considered by Philip Anderson and many others, actually. The importance of this model is the fact that it is probably the simplest model that has a landscape. So it is the simplest model that has many, many different minima. So it has not a single minimum, but it has many, many different minima because they correspond to the many, many different ways in which you can divide your cake. And any different minimum is a different configuration of the spins that are binary, so that you can have plus or minus spins, or and so on and so forth. And you can have similar energy with quite different spin configuration. So finding the minimum of this function is particularly complicated, and this was realized since many years, and also including Philip Anderson, that pointed out together with others that this is an NP complete problem. So finding the minimum of this Hamiltonian is a very hard combinatorial problem. And so we understand also that the original number partitioning problem is also an hard combinatorial problem. So there is a map that links different combinatorial problems, and we are using this map we can understand if a combinatorial problem is easy or not. So if you want to find the minimum of this function, what you do is the following. You actually may do a simple loop. You may start from some guess. Then you can generate another guess by some random choice. Then you evaluate the Hamiltonian, evaluate the energy. The value of the Hamiltonian is the energy. If the energy is smaller than your previous value, then you accept this new configuration as your new minimum. Otherwise, you generate another guess, and you go on and so forth to check for the best minimum that you can find. Photonics can enter here in the way we evaluate the Hamiltonian. I will try to convince you that photonics may speed up and accelerate this typical loop. To have an idea of the importance of this problem, I want to address the fact that this has been considered as one of the biggest challenges in physics. If you look to recent papers, now they deal to Ising Hamiltonian with 1 million of spins, more or less. So in this example, this is a recent example, they have 200 to the cube. So more or less 1 million of spin is the largest scale that we can consider. For practical application, we can probably limit to 1,000 or tens of thousands spins. So this is the size at which having a good approach to finding the minimum is actually relevant. Also, to understand this relevance, let me tell you some information about the so-called theory of complexity, a computational complexity. So assume that you have some problem to solve. For example, you want to sort a vector. You know that this is quite simple. You can use MATLAB and just say sort, and it is super fast. This kind of problem, like sorting a vector, is actually a problem that takes a polynomial time. So meaning that if you double the size of the vector, it will take two times to sort it. Or seemingly, you can multiply the vector times a matrix. This is also a problem which you can solve in a polynomial time. This kind of problem is typically considered as tractable. So you can do that in a reasonable time. However, the vast majority of the problem that you are dealing with, the interesting application, say, optimizing a portfolio for becoming rich with shares, or finding the best configuration for a protein to design some drug, these problems are not tractable in general. They are named the NP problem, which means non-deterministic polynomial time, which in barely you can keep in mind this complex expression as an exponentially demanding, an exponentially scaling time. So this kind of problem that you call NP, probably we scale exponentially with the sites in terms of time, and they are in general considered not tractable. So the problems that are interesting for us are actually not tractable. What does it mean? If you look, for example, to this super famous book about this kind of topic, it shows you by a simple example why we consider NP problem not tractable. If you solve a polynomial problem, a problem that scales polynomially with the sites, for example, you can sort a vector of sites 20, you may take, say, 20 microseconds. Then you go to a vector of sites 60, and it takes 60 microseconds. So this is what happens when you consider a problem which is polynomial. But if you consider a problem which is NP, and for example, you are able to solve this problem, for example, you are able to find the minimum of an Ising Hamiltonian with 20 spins, it may take 58 minutes. But then you try to go to 60, and it will take billions of centuries. So this is the issue here. We cannot tackle with this problem in a simple way. And the problem is their scaling. So actually, this is not a good situation for us because most of the problems that are interesting for us will take millions of years to be solved. Luckily enough, there is some kind of good news. And the good news is actually the existence of a class of problem that we call NP-complete. So among all the very super complicated problem that we know as NP, there is a class of problem that include Super Mario Bros. So the resources you need to finish Super Mario Bros. Or to finish Sudoku, or to minimize the Ising Hamiltonian, all these problems are named NP complete. They are all related. For example, we have seen that the number partitioning problem, which is also NP complete, maps to the Ising Hamiltonian. So all these problems are related. And if you are able to solve in a smart way one of them, you can map this solution to all the other problems. So if we specialize on a specific problem, we can use these special algorithms, special hardware, to solve, in some sense, all the other. So if you minimize the Ising machine, you can divide your cake among your friends and everybody is happy, or is at least happy in the best way possible. So this is good news because we do not need to solve any single problem independently, but we can focus on one of them. And actually, Ising Hamiltonian, so finding the minimum to an Ising Hamiltonian is one of the best studied NP problems. And many different authors have investigated the way not only to map a different combinatorial problem to finding the minimum of an Hamiltonian, but also to really find such a minimum. So these are many different hard combinatorial problems, like, for example, the famous traveling Selman or Glick or set packing, all of them, they have a lot of application in the society, so industry, engineering, science, economy, and all of them can be mapped to finding the minimum to this function. So it's quite important to find it this way. And for example, if you look to some recent papers, this one that recently appeared in Scientific Report, they just have used this mapping to address the way to optimize traffic signals in a town. So you can see how you can also map practical problems to the easing Hamiltonian. And another very interesting outcome recently is this Python package. By this Python package, you can, in some sense, map any combinatorial problem to easing models. Why this is so important? Why people is working so much at a level that they provide some kind of optimization interface to easing Hamiltonian? The reason is because most of the modern hype on quantum computing is actually quite related to finding the minimum of an easing Hamiltonian. For example, if you consider D-Wave, which is one of the most famous quantum computers at the moment, D-Wave is actually a device that finds the minimum of an easing Hamiltonian. And the scale of this device at the moment is of the order of 100 qubits, which means that it is not so interesting for real application, because as I told you, for real application, you need a scale which is 10,000 of spins. So there is still a lot of work to do in these things. And also using a quantum computer to do this kind of combinatorial optimization at the moment is a very complex story, but things are improving. And so I think we will see a lot of progress in this kind of direction. And this progress may be also including photonics. And so we arrive to the main goal that we may have in photonics beyond quantum computer. And the main goal is actually finding physical system, photonic system for us to do the minimization of an easing Hamiltonian. So this is not a new story. So people working in photonics has been already finding some links with the easing systems. And this dates back, for example, to 1985 by the work of Dimitri Psoltis and co-workers. And they have first realized a photonic system that implement the Hopfield model. The Hopfield model is just another name for an easing Hamiltonian, roughly speaking. And you can also check some books, for example, this one by Cornelia Dance. More recent years, I've seen a lot of new results concerning photonic accelerators to minimize easing Hamiltonians. These are actually devices that may eventually compete with quantum computers, or may eventually, in some sense, be integrated into quantum computers. Because these devices at the moment are classical photonic easing annealer, but we can expect in the future to become also real quantum computers. At the moment, the quantum computers based on that do annealing are mainly based on ultra cold ion systems, but I think that photonics can say a lot on that. And this is, for example, a very nice integrated device that has been developed by the group at MIT, in which they do this easing computing. I mean, an optical device that computes the easing Hamiltonian. There is also another interesting proposal for an easing machine, which is a coherent easing machine. This is a huge collaboration that involves many outstanding groups. And this is different from the previous example. In this case, they use an optical fiber. So as you can see, we have a proposal as integrated computer, integrated photonics. And this is another proposal, which is more near fiber optics, and in which you have many pulses propagating in a fiber, and each pulse represents a spin. I will not describe with detail this device, which is quite complex. But the message here is that it can reach 2,000 of spins, or even more than that in the new generation. But my goal in this lesson is to show you how you can do an easy machine by a super simple optical setup, which however reach a scale which is quite intriguing. And this was our work in 1 year ago, more or less, that we call the SPIM, that stands for Spatial Easing Machine, or Simple Photonic Easing Machine, if you prefer. So I will show you in a moment how this works. Actually, the goal is to do a device that can compute by photonics the Easing Hamiltonian. And the device is just a spatial modulator. And it works as follows. You have an amplitude modulated beam. In each point of the beam, you have some values of the amplitude. Then it goes to a spatial light modulator, which acts on the phase. This spatial light modulator impresses in each point of the beam a different phase. If the phase is zero, the spin is one. If the phase is pi, the spin is minus one. So you have amplitude and phase modulation. Then you have propagation and you form an image. And then you start working on the phases in order to change this image. And for example, you want to make this image equal to a target image. So, and I will show you that finding the spins, that is the phases that reduce this difference, is equivalent to finding the minimum of an Easing Hamiltonian. To understand this equivalence, we can just starting looking at the optical field on the spatial light modulator. This optical field has some amplitude, some phase. This number here can be either plus one or minus one, times some function. This function here is just the shape of each pixel. So for example, in this pixel here, you will have a square, which will be this function, centered at the center of the pixel, which is actually located in the Fourier plane. So each pixel will correspond to a different plane wave with different wave vector, and this is the shape of the pixel. So let's do some conventional optics with this simple arrangement. And let us see a little bit of mathematics. And everything is quite straightforward. So you start from your electric field in the Fourier plane. This electric field is actually the sum over all the pixels of your SLM, as I wrote before. Then we do propagation. And here we use one of the most powerful, of photonics. Photonics can do Fourier transform, and just by simple propagation. So we Fourier transform. So we go to the CCD camera, and we obtain the field in the plane of the at the entrance of the CCD camera, and it is a Fourier transform. And the Fourier transform, as you may know, is actually some exponential function times the Fourier transform or your rectangular function that represent your pixel. So this will be a sin x over x if you are modeling your pixel with a rectangular function. Then you evaluate the intensity because your camera measures the intensity. And this is just the modulus square of this expression. And so you have the modulus squares of a sum, which is a double sum. And so you have a quadratic function of the spins. Then you have the product of the amplitudes. Then you have your sinc squared. And then you have some exponential factor. Finally, you integrate the image by your CCD camera. So you get an image, and then you sum the intensity over the pixels of this image. And so we can read out all this x variable, and at the end of the day, the integrated intensity on the camera is actually your easing Hamiltonian, which actually shows that there is a link between dividing a cake and propagating an optical beam, which is quite intriguing to us. And the couplings are actually determined by the amplitude of your beam times some function that is the integral of the intensity on the CCD camera. You can do this integral in different ways. There is not just a single value. For example, you can integrate over a square and you will have some value here. You can consider one single pixel and you will have another value here. So you can control the couplings, not only by controlling the amplitude of the beams, but also by controlling the way you integrate intensity on the camera. So I think this is the simplest, the most straightforward way to show the very interesting link between optical propagation and the Easing Hamiltonian. And then you can do more sophisticated things that I will not describe with detail, but you can use a target image, you can use optical matrix vector multiplication, you can use nonlinear material, metamaterial, random material, or other more sophisticated mathematical processing to model many different Easing models. And the importance is in the fact that the more variability, the more control you have on your Easing model, the more sophisticated problem you can consider in your combinatorial optimization. So just to mention another possibility, you can, instead of integrating all the intensity, you can minimize the difference between your intensity and the target intensity. And it is possible to show that this is still equivalent to finding the minimum of an Hamiltonian. But in this case, the specific shape of your target intensity will also affect the couplings. So at the end of the day, just a propagation with a spatial light modulator can be mapped to the computing of the Easing Hamiltonian. And so this is super simple, but it is also interesting. It is interesting because the size of this a spatial light modulator is huge. If you attribute one spin to each pixel, you can reach 10 of millions of spins, which is already a scale which is quite competitive for real applications. And of course, the technology of the spatial light modulator is evolving. So with time, we will have faster and larger spatial light modulators. This is an example of minimization of this device in which we use this simple optical setup to compute the mean field Easing Hamiltonian. So we do iteration. Each iteration corresponds to the fact that you propagate, you take an image, and then you produce a new guess, and you go on and so forth to minimize the Easing Hamiltonian by using this simple optical accelerator. And as far as the iteration goes, you see that the values of the energy is reduced up to reach a stationary value. So you can use this approach to figure out the success probability. So once you have a machine that is able to compute this Hamiltonian, you can try to understand if it is working properly, which is the probability to have the minimum of this Hamiltonian after running the machine. And so you find this the following situation. You run your machine many, many times, and you obtain different values of the energy. Then you understand that you do not always reach the lowest value, but you reach the lowest value with a certain probability. This is the success probability of your machine. This is true for any kind of minimization strategy, and this is also true for photonic devices. So you have a certain probability to reach the lowest values. For example, you say, which is the probability to reach the lowest 5% of values of the Hamiltonian? Well, this is your success probability. So you fix an accuracy. Your accuracy says that you want a value of the energy in the lowest 5%. And then you see what is the probability to reach this range of energy. And for example, in our device, we reach success probability of the order of 90%, which is a good outcome in general. But this also is strongly dependent on the specific model that you implement, I mean, on the specific values of the couplings, and also is dependent on your hardware. So what is limiting the success probability in this kind of device? Well, the answer is simple, because any optical setup will have some noise. In particular, your spatial light modulator will in general fluctuate. So this will change your speckle pattern. This will change your image on the camera. So the fluctuation in your device will actually affect the success probability. And this can be also put in terms of easing models, I mean of a magnetic system. In some sense, noise in your device is like an effective temperature, a certain amount of fluctuations. This is not a physical temperature, but it's actually the equivalent temperature of the thermal bath in which your spins are immersed, are coupled with. And so, for example, in our device, we have in proper normalized units an effective temperature of the order of one. So if we are able to improve our setup, we can reduce such a temperature, which means that we can increase the success probability in our system. And let me show you other examples. For example, this one is a configuration in which we also use a disordered medium. So we do the same device, but we put some kind of a random medium in the middle, which can be just a sheet of paper or just some opaque medium that performs some multiple scattering of light. And if you do this, you can readily realize that you are implementing another easing Hamiltonian, which is a little bit different, in which the coupling distribution is random. So this is another very important model, which was also introduced in 1975. It's named the Sherrington-Kirkpatrick model. It is quite important as a model of a glassy system or spin glasses in physics, but it's also relevant for many combinatorial optimization. And in this model, your couplings are random coefficients. And how to introduce random coefficient in our setup? Quite simple, just put a random medium in the middle. And this is a fully connected model, which has a number of spins, which can be 10 to the 4 spins, with 10 to the 8 connection. It is not at all easy to do fully connected models with easing machines. So this shows how using optics and photonics, the situation may improve. So this is the working example for this optical machine. The goal here is to maximize the intensity in a square. So it is possible to show that to perform the modeling of the SK model, of this specific model, you need to maximize the intensity on a square in your overall image. So what you do, you just start changing the spins, changing the phase profile on the spatial light modulator to intensify the square inside of this image. And this is equivalent to finding the minimum of the easing Hamiltonian. This is the intensity inside this square as each iteration is done. And you see it increases, but different realization will have a spread. So you see that you do not always have the same value of the intensity, but the value of the intensity can change from one realization to another. This is the corresponding energy, which is minimized as the intensity is increased. And to have an idea, we are using a special light modulator that has 150 Hertz as a repetition rate, which means that we do 150 iterations each second. So here we have more or less 100 seconds. So it takes more or less 100 seconds to minimize the energy at the scale, which is 1000, which is quite an interesting result. And this is the distribution of the energies that we find. And these are the energies that the optical machine is able to find. And this one are the energies that you can find with your computer, with the best simulation of your computer. So looking at this situation, you realize that this is our optical computer. We want the energy as small as possible. So you may see, okay, so there is no advantage here. If I use my computer, I can do the same and my computer works much better. Yes, it is true. The computer may work much better, but first your computer is super optimized. Then our setup is super cheap and super simple, and we have a lot of things to do to improve. But there is a key message here. And the key message is the following. This is the time that you need to make an iteration. This is the time that you need to make an iteration with your computer, this one. And this is the time that you need to make an iteration with your photonic easing machine. If you notice, the time to compute the Hamiltonian for your computer is actually a quadratic function because you have a double sum. So it's a scale like n squared. So if you increase n, you expect a quadratic increase of the iteration time. On the contrary, the time to compute the Ising Hamiltonian is more or less independent of the number of spins. This is not surprising because the propagation is always the same. So it doesn't change if you put 100 spin or 1000 spin. It's always the same beam that is propagating. So it takes nearly independent time with respect to the number of spins. So this means that at some point, your computer will be much slower than your optical device. At some crossover, the time needed to compute the Hamiltonian by the optical system will be much smaller than the time you need to compute the Hamiltonian by a conventional computer. So at a certain point, there is an optical advantage. So your computer can be faster of your optical setup, but as far as you increase the number of spin, at a certain point, you will see that your optical setup will work better. And this is the key message here. So there is an optical advantage in performing this kind of computations. So there is also an upper limit, which is due to noise. We find that if the scale is too much, the fluctuation becomes so overwhelming that we cannot use this machine. So, but what is important is that the crossover is at a scale which is of the order of 1,000 spins, and for these sites, using an optical computer or an optical accelerator may be very, very interesting. Let me also mention some other developments. For example, in this kind of device by these authors in China, I guess they are in US, they use a nonlinear crystal, and they show that using a nonlinear crystal, you can implement more sophisticated easing Hamiltonian, including many body interactions. So I mean, not a quadratic function, but say a quartic function. And this is also important for several applications. And I want to finish by addressing another important aspect, which is meta-heuristics. So meta-heuristics are techniques to optimize the Ising Hamiltonian. And it is quite important that your optical device is also compatible with these techniques. And I will briefly show you that this is the case also for our simple easy machine. The simplest thing that you can do to improve your success probability in this machine is to use noise optimization. And now I will try to explain why. So you have a machine, it is working, but this machine has a lot of parameters. For example, the distance of the optical components, the integration time of the camera, the intensity of the laser. So there are several hyperparameters that you may optimize. And what can you expect from this optimization? Well, the first thing is to consider the optimization of noise. In minimizing these complex systems, what typically happens is that your system starts exploring a certain energy configuration, and at a certain time you find a minimum. But then you are stuck at this minimum, especially if you use a gradient descent or similar approach. So, and if you are stuck in a locked minimum, probably you can miss the lowest minimum. So your optimization is not smart enough to find the real minimum, but you are typically blocked in some local minimum. Now, if you have some fluctuations, it may happen that during your optimization, your system may jump from one local minimum to another one. So you may imagine that if you have enough of fluctuation, you may eventually reach the real ground state of your system. Now, the question is, can I just increase the noise, or something happen if the noise is too much? Well, if the noise is absent, you will be stuck in a minimum. But if you have a lot of noise, you will be bunching back and forth, never reaching any minimum. So there is an optimal noise. There is an optimal amount of noise to perform this minimization. And in our setup, it's quite easy to explore different noise, because if you look at the setup, you have a spatial light modulator, portion of that changes the amplitude, and a portion of that changes the phases. And then you have your beam that goes to amplitude modulation, then goes to spatial phase modulation, then to the CCD camera. This part here is routinely updating the phase. Now, your CCD camera shows some fluctuations, because as I told you, maybe the spatial light modulator is fluctuating in time. But if you change the integration time of the camera, the number of fluctuations will be reduced. So you can control the noise in this system just by acting on the integration time of your camera, which typically goes from, say, 10 milliseconds to seconds. So by changing this integration time, you can optimize the amount of noise in the system. And this is a very simple way to show how an optical setup can be useful. For example, here we show the success probability for different accuracy, varying the noise level. And you find that exists a noise level such that you can increase your success probability. And this is a simple way to optimize your device. And you can also check this optical noise looking at the some other metric. This is the humming distance, which is the distance from your best minimum. And we found that this distance is minimum also for optimal noise. So this is the simplest way to implement a meta heuristic in your easing machine. But you can do more sophisticated things with this kind of device. And probably the most important meta heuristic at the moment is the so-called adiabatic evolution. Now, adiabatic evolution is a technique which is used to optimize large-scale easy model. It's a quantum-inspired technique, which is used nowadays only numerically. So it's difficult to implement in real experiments. But, and we try to do this. So in adiabatic evolution, you consider a system in which you have an Hamiltonian that depends on time. In our case, decouplings, it depends on time. So you have a system that at the beginning of your iteration has a certain energy, has a certain coupling distribution, and at the end of the iteration has another coupling distribution. Why we are interested to this one? Well, actually, this is the strategy. You want to find the minimum of a very complex function, this one, and to find the minimum of this complex function, you start from a simpler function. So a smooth Hamiltonian, you reach the minimum for this smooth Hamiltonian, then you start deforming this Hamiltonian progressively and slowly. If you do this deformation slowly enough, you can stay on the minimum during the entire transformation. So at the end of your transformation, you will be in the ground state of your target problem. And this is named adiabatic following. It is adiabatic because you know you need to do this quite slowly. Otherwise, you will jump out from the global minimum during this, this transformation. So the speed at which you do this transformation is quite a relevant parameter. So we implemented this simple adiabatic following or adiabatic evolution in our setup as follows. Our setup has told us two SLM, or you can use just a single SLM. So you are routinely updating this part of the phase, and this part on the amplitude actually controls the couplings, as I've shown you. So by slowly changing the couplings, you can drive the system from a simple one to a complex one. And this is an example. We start from a system in which you have a simple Hamiltonian. This is more or less the distribution of the couplings. The couplings have more or less the same value for this simple Hamiltonian. So this is a mean field fully connected Hamiltonian with just one value of the coupling. So the solution is straightforward. All the spin are equal to one. And then we want to find the minimum of a more complex system in which couplings may have either positive or negative values. And to do this, we progressively deform our model during our minimization. And this is an example of this, of this kind of run in our system. So this is the system at the beginning of the minimization when your Hamiltonian is simple enough. And then when you go to the more complex system, you see that this quantity progressively adiabatically slows down. This quantity is the magnetization, which is the mean value of the spin, which is positive for this kind of model and zero for this kind of, for this kind of model. So we found that it is possible to do a simple approach to adiabatic following in an experiment. And now we need to demonstrate that this actually increases the success probability. And this is the dynamics of the spin. At the beginning, they are more or less all equal, and then they become more positive and negative in the frustrated model. But let us check the success probability. So this is the success probability. If we don't do annealing, we have more or less 60% of success probability. But if we do annealing, we see that if the annealing is too fast, so we do this transformation too fast, we drop. So we have a smaller success probability. But if we increase the time for annealing, at a certain point, this annealing procedure enables to increase the success probability at a level which is also 90%. So we pay in time because we need a lot of more time to do these kind of things, but we gain in success probability. And we also found that the success probability during annealing is nearly independent of the scale of the system. So by using adiabatic evolution, you can keep a high success probability at different scales. So there is also a good scaling. And so I arrived to the end of this lesson, in which I have shown you that you can implement different reasoning machines, and you can also implement sophisticated meta-heuristics in this kind of system with limited effort. And I stop here for this first lesson. And next lesson, that will be in a couple of days for me, will be about machine learning. So this has been about combinatorial optimization. The next one will be about machine learning.
Thank you very much, Claudio. Very exciting and stimulating talk, I would say. So you have already two questions, at least two, maybe three already. So can you see them, or should I read them to you?
Okay, no, I see them.
Okay, so let's start.
So I get the first one is mapping from minus one to. Yes. So the question is, the question is if you can use more phases. So I mean, multi-level phases. This is quite true. So using binary values is just the simplest thing that you can do. And you can actually use a different level to implement different combinatorial problems. This is true in general. The question also asked by Stenio if this is related to the fourth power minimization. This is the question is about the fourth power using Hamiltonian, I mean the nonlinear Hamiltonian. It's not necessarily related to nonlinear Hamiltonian. You can implement also combinatorial problem by using multi-level spins in general. So also still retaining the quadratic Hamiltonian, so without using more complex model, but having multi-level spins. This can be done. You pay in terms of noise. So if you increase the number of spins, you are more subject to fluctuations from one level to another, because you have a smaller distance between different levels. This is the typical case when you have a multi-level system. So then I have another question from Muhammad. What is JJ for this setup? Okay, so JJ in this setup, in the simplest case, is just the product of the amplitude. So maybe, I don't know if I managed to do that in a simple way, but I have considered a different setup. For example, in the simplest one, JJ is just the product of C1 XCH, or CI and CA, and this is a constant. So this is the simplest formulation that corresponds to the number partitioning problem. SLM can be Booleans, yes, but the SLM phases can be Boolean, but this number here can be real, because you use the simultaneous way amplitude and phase modulator. So the amplitude can be any real value, because for example, you have 12 bits in your SLM, so you can impress any real value by 12 bits, and then you use another part as a Boolean variables.
So I really see a lot of questions coming. I really appreciate it. It's atmosphere. Yes. So if you can go down, Claudio, you can see.
Well, it's a huge. So I need to shorten my answers.
Okay. You
can do both positive and negative. Yes, you can do both positive.
You still have time. Yeah.
Yes. Then Mario, I have a question. I missed the part of hypoplasia. It asked, yes. Well, actually, the problem is, so the question is, can you modulate both phase and amplitude, or you can just do first phase and then amplitude? It depends. You are optimizing on the phase. So It's better to do the phase after, because this will be the part that will be directly linked to the CCD camera. So you can modulate the phase after, but this depends on whether you're using a single SLM or two SLM. If you use a single SLM, it's more or less equivalent if you do first phase or amplitude. But if you use two SLM, of course, the second SLM will be nearer to the CCD camera. So they are distinct and better to do first amplitude and then phase. About the compression, then there is a by Anas here. So about the compression, I hope Sergei, please stop me if my time is ending.
No, it's all right. Actually, we have coffee break, and I believe in the spirit of the school, we should just continue. Everybody should be free in 5 minutes to take coffee. But I suggest to bring coffee here and have discussions. And if Claudia kindly can delay his coffee, that would be fine.
I can survive. So about the compression speed of the Hamiltonian minimum, has there been work used? Okay, so the question, if there is some example of deep learning to find the minimum configuration of spins. Well, this is a very complex story. There is a huge amount of literature that connect the spin system and deep learning since 40 years. And things like that. There are techniques at the moment that use neural network to mimic using spin. But this is really a very complicated story, because you need to train a neural network to reproduce the values of energy in a complex system. So you are trying to use a complex system, which is a huge neural network, to mimic another complex system. And it is not clear if it is actually a clever way to do these things. And of course, you also ask if there is a link to compare it to classical computer. Okay, at the moment, we do not know an answer on this. So we do not have an answer about the fact that if using a deep neural network to mimic easing model is better to be done with a photonic or electronic system. This is at the moment too much complicated question, but there is an important comment that I want to do, which is the following. There are new quantum computers that are emerging at the moment, using photonics. And now people is trying to train these quantum computers to perform like easing machine. So it's a completely different way to the conventional quantum computing. In conventional quantum computing, for example, D-Wave, you have a system that makes some annealing. So it is an easing machine. But there is a new class of quantum computers that are based on photonic system. They are not easing machine, but someone wants to train them to behave like an easing machine, which is really a fascinating approach that is being developed. And the nice story here is that by using this concept, you can have any optical any setup, and you can force this setup to do what you want instead of doing what it wants. And you can do that if you have enough degree of freedoms in general. So if you have enough degree of freedom, if you are at a scale which is large, you can eventually do these kind of things. But typically you pay in scale. For example, if you have, say, 1,000 spins, then you can simulate an easing model with 10 spins. So you pay a lot in the sites, but you can force one physical system to behave like another physical system. I think it's a very exciting direction. What about calibration regarding noise? So I'm not sure I understand this question, but actually the SLM is typically calibrated by usual techniques that you use, and you use also correction to the SLM to correct the real phase that impress. So you perform the typical setup, but at the end of the day, even if you do this, your SLM will also have some noise that you cannot remove. So you know that you can remove by calibration the deterministic part of the noise, but your SLM will also have, will always have fluctuations, and this will affect your success probability. Then another question by Omar. Can we consider, okay, good question. So the question is an SLM a nonlinear system to do optical neural network? So the answer is yes or no. First, yes. So is an SLM a nonlinear system? You can use an SLM to encode an image. So if you are using a phase SLM, actually you do the cosine of your image. So the cosine of the image is actually a nonlinear function. So the SLM can, in principle, work as a nonlinear function. The problem is that typically the phase that you impress are weak enough to not have a strong nonlinearity. So the SLM can introduce some nonlinearity, but the nonlinearity is not enough to perform in the proper way a neural network. I will discuss this topic in more detail in the next session, in the next lesson, and I will touch precisely the problem of nonlinearity. So, but in principle, SLM can introduce some nonlinearity. It depends on the encoding of your stuff. So next question by Mehdi Mabed, sorry for the pronunciation. You use adiabatic evolution for an no, simulated annealing, which means random sampling. So in the optimization, we don't do gradient descent, because to do gradient descent, you have to compute gradients. And this means more running stuff on your machine. It's much better to use gradient-free optimization strategy in the first implementation. Then you make complicated story, but we prefer to avoid gradient using optimization techniques. Then Lorenzo, yes, the question is, do you use a sort of simulating annealing to escape the local minimum? In this case, we tried both. So in generally, we prefer to avoid too much complicated algorithm. So in the first implementation, we just use random patterning. So we randomly flip some spin, and then we check the energy. Then we also have implemented some more sophisticated algorithm, but typically we prefer to remove as much as possible in the computing time. So we prefer to use a very simple algorithm in the optimization on the photonic machine, which is because we want to focus on the optical part. But then you can, but the machine is also compatible with more advanced heuristics. Then he's asking, so what is the difference between using meta heuristic in the device? So, for example, implementing the adiabatic evolution using the device, or doing the same using the computer. So you may forget about doing optical annealing in the device, and you can just use the computer. Well, actually, you need to do, for example, adiabatic evolution, if I understand the question, you need to control the couplings. But to control the couplings, you need to control the way you compute the Hamiltonian. And this can be done optically. So you cannot use your computer to control the couplings, because the couplings are in the optical part of your Hamiltonian. So I hope this is the proper question, to the proper answer to your question. Okay. I don't see other, so
thank you, Claudia, for answering the question. So we have now coffee break. And in the normal school, people would grab coffee and talk to each other and introduce each other. Let's use this chat as some possibility for that, but now it's coffee break. And I suggest everybody will come around 20 to what, to 12, right? And we will start in 15 to 12, okay? Coffee break now, and thank you, Claudio, again.
Thank you, thank you.
David is theoretical physicist by education, as probably many of lecturers, and but yes, he is a